talk about names. Names are central to our humanity as humans. It's one of the hardest things to forget. No matter how out of body our astral projections may be, it's one of the only things that can snap us back into reality immediately. As the youngest in my family, my name and its many configurations rang through the house, signifying any number of needs, demands, and warnings, ranging from the need for something to be carried, shuttled, or smuggled into the house, to demand my immediate presence to explain some broken or missing item, or in the case of the use of my full name, to warn me of the impending storm of accountability and guilt coming my way. Historically, names are some of the most talked about words in humanity. The exact date when humans started using names is lost in the waves of time, but evidence suggests it likely began around 10 to 12,000 years ago. Originally, names, in their simplest form, were based on physical attributes or characteristics which helped to differentiate one from another. As societies began to advance, so did the use of and uniqueness of names. In China, names began to emerge between 4000 and 3000 BC. In Egypt, early hieroglyphics indicate names in use by 3000 BC. But it wasn't until 700 BC that there was evidence of advanced naming or trinomina in Europe, specifically in the Roman Empire. In our individual histories, names dominate the single word impact pie chart. Our names are some of the first words we recognize and respond to. Babies respond and recognize it as early as 4 to 9 months. Not only does the consistent hearing and recognition of one's name help bond babies with their family and immediate caregivers, hearing your own name plays a crucial role in our emotional, social, and cognitive well-being. Hearing our name is often the cornerstone on which we form our identity and self-esteem, helping build and reinforce confidence in who we are. The use of our name by the people around us fosters positive connections with friends, families, and caregivers by building trust and reinforcing feelings of security. As we grow older and mature socially and emotionally, the importance of names matures simultaneously. When we first meet people, the tone, nature, and correct usage of their name can help create a positive first impression. Our names can also carry the weight of unconscious bias and stereotypes associated with names. For example, the name Karen has adopted a challenging connotation for overly involved strangers who feel racist and ignorant. Microaggressions are useful techniques to keeping their neighborhood safe or addressing unsafe activity. Changing one's name can be an empowering act and can reflect a significant shift in identity or life circumstances. Names can hold spiritual, religious, and cultural significance, illustrating the historical significance of our being, or simply keeping record of our practical existence here on Earth. Names can also trigger neurochemical responses in our brain, releasing oxytocin, a hormone associated with feelings of trust and bonding. Overall, our names are powerful tools which help sculpt the intricacies of our life. The psychological impact can help us in profound ways. However, like all things in life, there is a converse. Historically, names have been weaponized, wielded by colonial, assimilatory, and oppressive regimes. Since the dawn of America, names were swung like a sword in an effort to decapitate the identity and cultural strength of native and oppressed persons of color. Colonial efforts to assimilate indigenous people used forced name changes to break the thread of cultural ties and community and individual identities. The most damning of these practices happened in the residential schools of the 19th and 20th centuries. Forced name changes were a brutal form of cultural oppression with lasting psychological effects. The forced removal of children from their communities, forced name changes, and forced assimilation into whiteness was not accidental in any way. This was not about administrative efficiency. It was a deliberate attempt to sever ties with their heritage, dehumanize and control their psyche, and force an assimilation into the dominant society. These inhumane practices were not reserved for indigenous people. Forced name changes are a hallmark of American slavery, and were a highly effective tool for the dehumanization and control. Upon capture or arrival in America, enslaved peoples were stripped of their given names. And as we know from earlier, names hold deep cultural and personal significance, empowering humans with a deep sense of identity, belonging, and connection. Slave owners researched this psychological fact, and knowing this, forcibly stripped their slaves of that connection. These severed connections made collective healing nearly impossible. The loss of identity, not only through the separation and displacement of families and tribes, but the loss of one's own name means losing a core part of yourself. The use of derogatory names can inflict psychological wounds, damage self-esteem, and create a deep sense of self-loathing and allow for oppression to be internalized. The long-term effects of this perpetuating intergenerational trauma can cause cultural suppression and foster internalized oppression. Understanding and recognizing the lasting harm of forced name changes is crucial to understand the legacy of slavery and oppression in America and across the globe. Despite this feeling like and sounding like distant history, society is still facing many challenges related to names. These challenges exist even here at Brooks. Getting someone's name wrong or simply misspelling it can have a multitude of negative effects on the psyche of your peers. Some people have deep connections to their names, and the mistaken use, mispronunciation, and misspelling of their name can feel disrespectful and hurtful. While the one-time mistake can be brushed off, the persistent misuse can cause lasting damage to the victim. Reduced self-esteem, cultural suppression, and feelings of invisibility are all effects of messing up people's names. Here at Brooks, we teachers mess up people's names regularly. It's a natural part of life, and while we would love to be perfect, we also make mistakes. While I am cognizant of our human tendency for mistakes, I think the response is more important than the transgression. How we respond to a mistake is the best way to show care, attention to detail, all while building trust and strengthening communal bonds. Instead of laughing it off, pretending like it doesn't matter, or awkwardly making a joke about the similarities between the students whose names you mistook, try taking accountability and apologizing. Be upfront and honest about the mistake. And don't try and pretend like you didn't or don't remember making one. Give your ego a break and accept the fact that you might not be able to pronounce the name correctly. Don't double down or cower in fear by making excuses for your ignorance. I've mixed up names as recently as last week. Am I embarrassed in the moment? Of course. Do I feel as though I have devalued the student by confusing them with someone else? Without a doubt. But like we teach our children, or I teach my nieces, or we all teach our students, the only way to defeat failure is to learn from it. Acceptance and accountability are the foundation for a strong community of relationships. The complexity and layered nature of residential education is only strengthened by cultures of accountability. Acknowledging wrongdoing helps build trust and respect, encourages open communication, promotes forgiveness and understanding, all while strengthening and promoting empathy and compassion. In our professional relationships, it can enhance one's credibility and integrity and promotes a culture of growth and learning. As someone who's shortened his name for the ease of my colleagues, invented aliases for public use, I continue to wrestle with the balance of holding firm in my identity by using my full name, or making life easier by not having to demonstrate the pronunciation for every new person I meet. I stand here in my mid-30s, numb from decades of concessions, numb from years of having my name mispronounced in meetings and social introductions, misspelled in emails, and even on event registrations, and even on employment contracts. As I stand here, numb from years of disrespect, I'm here to tell you, the young people in the room, to be better than me. Stand up for your name. Demand that it is spelled, pronounced, and used correctly. Do not let ignorance, lack of attention to detail, and disrespect erode your strength of self and identity. Hold your peers and teachers accountable for their actions, and let's not repeat the atrocities of our history and begin to use empathy to guide our moral compass and actions. Thanks. two top five lists. All right, here we go. Let's have some fun. All right, top five movie character names. Number five, Morpheus, Larry Fishburne, The Matrix. Classic name, classic guy, classic decision, red pill, blue pill. Number four, Samson Simpson, played by Dave Chappelle in Half Baked. All right. Number three, Vic Damone Jr., Chris Tucker in Money Talks. It's a made-up name, but also a real name. Solid movie, solid actor. Number two, Jericho Jackson, a.k.a. Action Jackson, in Carl Weathers' Action Jackson, R.I.P. Carl Weathers. And lastly, the most fear-inducing villain in a movie ever, Chong Lee, played by Bolo Young in Bloodsport. All right, and then lastly, we have our top five nicknames in sports. Here we go, number five, the one, the only, Big Papi, David Ortiz. All right, number four, the legend, White Chocolate, Jason Williams, he's a streetball legend, an NBA legend. Number three, the Hick from French Lick, Larry Bird, AKA Larry Legend, Boston Celtic legend, obviously. Number two, the Egyptian King, Mohamed Salah, Liverpool, top of the table. Let's go. And lastly, number one, the big O, Oscar Robertson, but really, more importantly, Oliver McCain, the best dog on earth, my favorite dog here on campus. Thank you all. Have a great day.